In 1981, America made history when NASA launched its first space transportation system, carrying two astronauts into orbit. But unbeknownst to many, Russia was in the middle of building its own spacecraft, with stolen parts and specifications acquired through espionage. As the most ambitious project in the history of the Soviet space conquest, over a million people from 1,286 companies and 86 ministries and departments participated directly in the project's development. Then, on November 19, 1988, Soviet cameras recorded the Buran space shuttle successfully taking off into orbit. While Buran may have looked like any other Soviet vehicle from the Cold War, the now-forgotten space shuttle had one unique characteristic. It could fly itself. One of their own. For decades, Soviet scientists toyed with many ideas to develop reusable spacecraft, but the rapid development of the American space shuttle in the early 1970s further motivated them to build one of their own. Even if the United States always claimed that its space efforts came merely from national pride and the pursuit of science, the military applications of such a massive vehicle were clear, at least to the Russians. Amongst the Soviets, there was fear that the new American spacecraft could be used as some sort of orbital bomber for global domination. With that in mind, the Soviet Council of Ministers and the Communist Party's Central Committee approved plans to develop a new space shuttle in early 1976. The effort would be led by Colonel General Alexander Maximov, a military official already managing Russia's existing military space programs. Initially, the Soviets considered restarting Spiral, a previous space plane program. However, when that design proved insufficient compared to America's upcoming shuttle, they recognized just how far behind they were. If the Soviets wanted to keep pace with NASA, they would need to expedite the design process via old-school espionage. Digital espionage. While no strangers to reverse engineering Allied technology, the design plans for the space shuttle would undoubtedly be hard to steal. Luckily for the Russians, America's National Aeronautics and Space Administration, or NASA, was a civilian agency delineated from the military and did not treat its shuttle program like it was developing a weapon system. As such, the documentation and plans for the space shuttle were available to the public. In fact, most of the material the Soviet Union needed was hosted on commercial databases, making this one of the first ever cases of digital espionage. According to a CIA analysis of the Soviet acquisition of militarily significant Western technology, the documents the competing nation acquired described in detail airframe designs, materials, flight computer systems, propulsion systems, and more. Such documents allowed the Soviet industries to save years of scientific research, as well as millions of rubles. Finally, in 1980, Soviet Russia began building the Buran, or Snowstorm, space plane. At its peak development and construction phase, the project integrated over 150,000 engineers, scientists, technicians, and other employees, with most of the factory workers not knowing precisely what they were building for a while. The Soviets always tried to keep the program a secret, but word soon leaked out. In 1982, Australian reconnaissance aircraft took photos of Russian ships pulling a small model spacecraft out of the ocean that looked strikingly familiar to American eyes. Doppelganger. Despite an unmistakable aesthetic resemblance, the Buran spacecraft's design departed from the American space shuttle in several ways. While some of the most celebrated Soviet test pilots flew the Buran on training flights in the Earth's atmosphere, the Soviet shuttle was designed to travel without needing a human operator. Another significant difference between the two models was the engine design. While the American spacecraft system's three main engines were meant to return with the orbiter back to Earth after each flight, Buran's four engines were located in a separate, disposable rocket stage. Moreover, the Buran spacecraft was designed to be launched on the Soviet Union's massive lift vehicle, Energia. The immense power of the Energia provided the mighty Soviet rocket with the capability to place payloads of over 100 tons in low Earth orbit, while the American shuttle could only carry what fit inside its cargo bay into space. Such flexibility was one of the design's focal points, particularly during the Cold War, in which space stations were a likely possibility, partly because of President Ronald Reagan's famed Star Wars missile defense program. First flight. After several years of delays, preparations for the launch of the first Buran began in the fall of 1998. However, the first launch attempt was canceled less than 1 minute prior to liftoff because of a computer error, and a second try was again scrubbed due to poor weather. Finally, on November 15th, more than 7.5 years after the American space shuttle Columbia lifted off for the first time from the Kennedy Space Center, the Russians were ready to give it a go. At 6 a.m. local time, Buran was launched from the Baikonur Cosmodrome in Kazakhstan, with the stack disappearing into low clouds only seconds later. The event was recorded and published not long after, with hundreds of thousands of people as witnesses. Despite carrying Polyus, an experimental military space platform, as its payload, the Soviet shuttle departed without a crew on board as planned. The Buran spacecraft first reached low Earth orbit on the back of its giant Energia super heavy lift launch vehicle. From there, the Soviet Wonder boosted itself into a slightly higher orbit to circle the Earth twice before beginning re-entry. Without jet engines, the Soviet space shuttle would have to glide back to its runway at the Baikonur Cosmodrome, just like its American counterpart, but without a pilot to manage the descent. As expected, the Buran spacecraft touched down on Earth shortly after re-entry, making what top Soviet engineers called a flawless runway landing. The orbiting flight was notable around the world for being the first to return from space with an airplane-style landing controlled entirely by a computer. And upon closer inspection, the spacecraft's heat shielding fared better than America's first shuttle launch years before, proving to be a resounding success. Untimely collapse. With lots of new data to work with, the Soviet scientists began preparing for a second launch. However, it would sadly never come. After only a single but successful flight in 1988, the Buran program quickly ran out of funds, as the now crumbling Soviet Union realized the lack of purpose for the system compared to its high cost. The price tag for launching 20 tons of payload on the system was around 270 million rubles at the time. Only 3 years after the Soviet space shuttle's first and only successful flight, the Russian government collapsed, and with it, any hope of ever putting it back into orbit. In 1993, Yuri Semenov, the director of NPO Energia, finally admitted that the project was finished, while NPO Molnaya, the developers of the Buran's body, tried to move forward with a smaller version of the reusable orbiter. The company never found investors for the project. The system was ultimately destroyed years later when its hangar at Baikonur Cosmodrome collapsed in a massive accident. While the Buran orbiter had a very brief operational life, most of the research and technology that went into it would later prove helpful in the Russian-designed elements of the International Space Station, which was inaugurated in 1998. Thank you for watching Dark Footage. If you enjoyed our video, please give us a thumbs up and share it with someone who might enjoy it. Also, don't hesitate to check out all our other Dark Documentaries channels, where we dive deep into many of the most incredible weapons in the world and their use in modern warfare. We publish regularly, so stay tuned.